Hello everyone, this is a follow-up to my video about lithium-ion pack for Roland V accordion. I am going to see how difficult it is to add a battery management system or BMS to this pack. One possible outcome is that it does not make much sense, and if it does, I am going to add this BMS, which I bought in the process of my investigation or evaluation. Unfortunately, this model does not have balancing, but it should be good enough. It doesn't have to be perfect. So let's take this heat shrink wrapping off and have a look. Here we are. I believe this is hot glue which holds the pack together. This is a temperature sensor, 10K thermistor. And the cells are soldered here, not welded. And between the cells, I think I see something like this desoldering wick, which is quite good for this purpose. Flat and flexible copper wire, which can handle a lot of current. And this is a thermal fuse, and I don't like the placement of it at all. It is convenient for assembling the pack, but I believe it's too far away from all the cells. It should be placed somewhere in the middle of the pack, just like the temperature sensor. So, to install this BMS, we need to take this pack apart and solder wires between all the cells. And I think we should be able to warm up this hot glue and take this thing apart. Not super easy, but should be doable. Let's take a look at the thermal fuse. The marking is not quite clear, hardly readable in some places. The brand is Microtemp. This line must be date code and plant code. This must be part number, E, and then 1 or 4, I'm not sure. A and 50, we can better see that on the next picture. And this is voltage rating, 250 volts. Let's have a look at the next picture. So this 50 in the part number, 250 volts. And this is TF, which stands for functioning temperature. And on the other side, we can see current rating after 250 volts, 10 amps. And this is TF, 144 degrees C. Let's take a brief look at this datasheet. I have to clarify something about these thermal fuses. There was a discussion in the comments below my previous video, and I believe there was some confusion about the purpose of these thermal fuses. This is the first page describing the purpose, upper limit temperature protection, and some features. And pay attention to this one, it is important. Current interruption capacity up to 25 amps, depending on the model. And operating principle is described here, but we can better see it, I believe, on these two pictures, before operation and after operation. There is a metal case with a lid attached to it. Then this thermal pellet, which is supposed to melt at particular temperature. And then this compression spring, which presses this disc against this tip, which is attached to the other lid. And this lid goes through this epoxy seal and this ceramic bushing, which supports this trip spring. So, when this thermal pellet melts, this compression spring relaxes, and then this trip spring should be able to move away this disc from this tip, and that interrupts the circuit. Here is the operating temperature table and this main rating parameter, TF, and we have this one, 144 degrees C. And marking on the case is described here, microtemp, then manufacturing plant and date code, then primary part number, we didn't have that, secondary part number, and then we've seen this TF, three numbers and C. And finally, definition of terms here, and in particular rated current. the maximum current that the thermal fuse is rated to interrupt at the rated voltage. So, the only purpose of these ratings is to specify maximum for the fuse to open properly. If voltage is too high, then there might be an arc over the small gap, and if the current is too high, then the contacts might be welded together during opening, and that might prevent them from opening properly. These fuses are not designed to provide an overcurrent protection at all. The overcurrent protection fuses have particular current rating at which they should blow within particular time frame, and there are no such specifications here at all. I started removing this glue and it was not hard so far. I just pulled on this end with pliers and I did not even need to warm it up. It came right off. Perhaps slightly damaged that sticker, but that's not a problem. I managed to remove this much so far. It was not too difficult. And now I think it's time to desolder this thermal fuse before I break it. And I have a few more reasons why this placement is not a very good idea. First, this mounting seems to be too rigid. If there's any movement here, it can put too much stress on this epoxy seal and break it. And also it is exposed to outside stresses. Someone might just push in this area without realizing that there is a fuse right under a thin wrapping. One more problem is that the leads are too short, especially this one, and it might make soldering difficult without transferring too much heat into the fuse and melting it, perhaps partially. And if it melts partially, it might work for a while and then fail at some point, just go open with no apparent reason. Soldering should be done with some heat sinking, for example using a clip like this, like so, but because this lead is so short, this might not be very effective. And one more problem is that this heat shrink wrapping is right on top of the fuse, so it is hard to avoid melting it in the process of shrinking this. I'm not going to reuse this thermal fuse, I'm going to use this new one. 115 degrees C, 2 amps rated. I am going to put it in the middle of the pack and I will keep these long leads and extend them with these wires, solder using this heat sinking clip and connect between the positive of the pack and the output. I discharged the pack before taking it apart, so now, before wrapping it, I ran a full charge test and it finished, and I described this test setup in my previous video. And here is a plot. The blue line is voltage, and the red line is voltage change on the temperature sensor, and this range is slightly more than 10 degrees C. Charging took slightly more than 3 hours and terminated around 29.5 volts, as expected due to overcharge protection threshold in the BMS. And this time there was no temperature rise at the end of charge, as with another BMS we have seen in my previous video. That was due to balancing of the cells, and this BMS does not have that feature. We have a complication here. It turns out that with this pack, the accordion is not quite happy at the end of charge. It shows this battery status hardware error message and the flashing red light. And there is no problem with the charging process. I measured it and the plot looks the same. It's just a confusing message at the end of charge. And for some reason it does not happen with this experimental pack from my previous video. It looks different because I put heat shrink on it and this label. And here it is in the accordion, and it is fully charged, so it shouldn't take long. Let's give this a go. There you go, charging completed message and the green light, no problem. I am inclined to call this good enough. There is no problem with charging, just a bit confusing message at the end. It is unfortunate, but knowing the reason, we can easily tolerate it, I suppose. And this BMS seems to work fine by itself, but apparently there is a subtle difference they interact with the accordion. So I would recommend using this module instead. My limited testing did not reveal any problem with this one, and it is a bit cheaper, about $5, and this one was about $9, and this one also supports balancing. Let's wrap this thing. I used higher temperature heat shrink on this pack, because I didn't have the right one at that time and I didn't want to wait. This time I ordered the right one, which is PVC heat shrink. It takes about 90 degrees C to shrink, and this is 80 mm tubing, which seems to be just the right size. And I'm going to use a piece of this foam on this side of the pack, not on the other side. It's going to be too thick to fit into the battery compartment. So this is going to protect BMS from damage and further insulate the thermal fuse, which is under the BMS and under this piece of foam. So it should survive the process of shrinking just fine. Something like this should do. Not the best heat shrinking job, I don't have much experience with it, and I tried to be careful not to heat it up too much. So, was this modification easy? I'm not sure about that. With some tools and materials and experience, it's not too bad. Tedious, but doable. And if you are going to try something like this, please be careful not to damage the cells, not to short anything. Discharge the pack before working on it. Please make sure you know what you are doing, and if you don't, then perhaps you shouldn't. Thanks for watching. Bye.